Councilmember Chapman?
Here.
Councilmember Clayton?
Thank you.
Here.
Councilmember Kendall?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
We will now stand for a silent prayer, moment of reflection. We will now salute the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, PL 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster, and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. We're on now to item E, proclamation. We have a proclamation recognizing Childhood Cancer Awareness Month.
Is there anyone here to accept this?
No.
Can you read it anyway?
Yep, read it.
Whereas September is nationally recognized as Childhood Cancer Awareness Month, and whereas cancer is the leading cause of illness related deaths in U.S. children under 15 years of age, surpassing AIDS, asthma, cystic fibrosis, diabetes, muscular dystrophy combined, and whereas every school day, 46 children or two classrooms of students will be diagnosed with, and 250 children, the equivalent of a movie theater audience, will succumb to cancer. And whereas in the last 25 years, only two drugs have been developed specifically for children's cancer, two-thirds of those patients
We now have a proclamation recognizing Monmouth Conservation Foundation.
Monmouth Conservation
I must tell everybody how thrilled I was. I think it was August 29th that there was this spiritual choir from Harlem. And I went with a friend, and we brought our picnic dinner, and there was a mixture of races sitting together, just enjoying that beautiful space that Springwood Avenue has become. That park is extraordinary. And you did a great job, and you're to be commended, because this is something that had to happen in Asbury Park, and you finally agreed that it should happen. And I remember when, I don't remember if any of you people came, but it was like 7-8 years ago when this started to percolate, and by golly, it happened, and it was thrilling. If you haven't been, you should go, because it's extraordinary. Thank you very much, Yvonne, because this lady here, she really is the spark plug for the whole thing. Thank you, dear.
We now have a proclamation recognizing Reverend Gilbert Caldwell.
Read some. something very quickly, there's parts of it and all of it, and then I got dropped into this. When I first came to Asbury Park, I was made aware of east, west, the kinds of divisions within this community. And as I thought about that, I found, not a professional, but an artist, I said, if in fact you captured in art what Asbury Park is, and therefore he developed a logo that you will have, for those of you who picked it up from the table, surrounded by the words unity and community. And that's important. But what I want to read is something that I wrote in 2006, because following 9/11, but it has, I think, meaning for us here in Asbury Park. There was a poet who, after 9/11, wrote a powerful poem about the destruction, particularly the Tintwall College in New York. She told that to Game One. Let me just read a portion of what I presented with you ahead. Years ago in Jamaica, there was a violent conflict between the followers and political parties of Michael Manley and Edward Zianna. If you remember that conflict. And Bob Marley pulled the people together in a massive outdoor rally under the banner of his popular and powerful song, One Love. You know One Love and Bob Marley?
Yes.
You know that? My prayer is that all of the persons and groups and sections and factions, the young and the not so young of this great little city by the sea, Asbury Park, will in our discussions, debates, and our decision making demonstrate a unity and love that makes what was thought to be impossible become possible. We owe that to ourselves, but more importantly, we owe that to those who will be here long after we have died. And then these are the words that jump out at me, for in fact they capture, I think, what we all want for the city. We recognize there are differences among us, and we recognize that there's some makeup that has to be made. I use the word reparations, but for me reparations is not financial. But it's a recognition of the kind of history, the African-American history. I guess one of the things that I hope the city will do is to somehow relate to that museum that's opening in Washington on the 24th. How meaningful we if we can do that. But the second thing is that I'm hopeful that there is a program called One City, One Book. And I think it would be interesting if maybe during Black History Month, we as a city could read the same book. Pam Lamerton had discovered the North Side that talks about Atlantic City. That might be the book. And suggesting that we read a book in our homogeneous settings rather than creating artificial interracial groups, because there is a need to talk about race in groups where we feel comfortable, where we can be honest, rather than in groups that we don't know. And so I suggest that. So here's what I close with. These are her words. We became one. And just imagine the Twin Towers and what happened there. We became one as we cried tears of grief and loss. We became one soul. As we retell with pride the sacrifices of heroes, we became one people. We are one color, one class, one generation, one gender, one faith, one language, one body, one family, one soul, one people. We are the power of one. We are united. We are America. We are Asbury Park. Thanks, guys.
We are on to item F, matters from City Council.
So I would just like to acknowledge our Asbury Park City employees. I think we had an incredible summer this year. I don't remember ever seeing the amount of visitors that we've had this year and previous years. And our employees and our lifeguards helped to make our community safe and clean. So just wanted to acknowledge them.
Yes, I have one. I'd like to just thank everybody that was involved in the Summer Musical Festival. For the first time, it was a success. We thank you for everything that you put forth, your efforts, your just coming out there to just acknowledge the music that we had. One more thing, I'm wearing these glasses. A lot of you might say, well, what are you doing up there with sunglasses? They're not sunglasses. It's just something that I have an eye problem with light. And when you get that certain age, sometimes it just bothers you. So you'll see me with his glasses on and off. It's not, I'm not sitting up here trying to be cool. I'm just trying to see everybody. Thank you.
I just want to remind everybody, this Saturday, a organization called the Sunshine Girls Charities reached out to Asbury Park wanting to honor the victims of Orlando who were shot in the Pulse nightclub. This Sunshine Charity group donated 49 trees to the city of Asbury Park and plaques. We've had a number of people donate their services like Asbury Audio, Armstrong Trees. They got rid of a lot of the dead trees that were in Library Park. So that planning is on Saturday. It starts at 8. It's 49 trees, so as many of you that can get there, the better. Home Depot donated about 20 shovels to us, but we're just requesting people bring shovels. We're going to have a short program. The Tides and the Asbury Hotel have teamed up and flew in a number of survivors, and the Asbury Hotel is comping their rooms. So we have about 7 survivors of the Pulse nightclub shooting coming in, a couple of them speaking, a family member from the Pulse nightclub coming in, and Lake House is going to have kids from Asbury Park sing some songs at the beginning and end of the program. Since people are going to be there from 4 to 11:30 or 12 planting trees, the program should be short. So I'm hoping it doesn't go longer than an hour. But anyone here that can make it to that, that would be wonderful. We would encourage all of you to come. The planning starts at 8. The program will start depending on, you know, a little of this is depending on how quickly we get these trees planted. So I would say if you want to catch the program, get there no later than 11:30, but I can't guarantee that we're going to start at 11:30. And I want to specifically thank our DPW department who put in an electrical outlet for us for, you know, the PA system. And I want to thank Michelle Alonzo, who I don't know if she's here, but has tirelessly walked that park with the head of the Shade Tree Commission, Tom Pavinsky, to not only identify and get rid of the trees that were dead and have been dead since Sandy, and some of these trees were monumentally big, but has found spots to put all of these trees while also keeping in mind the historical preservation element of Library Park. A big kudos to you know, the city departments that have made this effort come to fruition.
I just want to announce that Meridian Health is running a program where they are providing free mammograms to anyone regardless of your insurance status. And they will also provide free transportation and free diagnostics. So there will be referral forms in the lobby of City Hall if anyone needs one. And if nothing else, you can always call me directly and I will see that you get the information. And this program is going to be running through March of 2017. So anyone that is in need of, or if you know of anyone who is in need of a mammogram, this is an opportunity for them to have free mammograms, free transportation, free diagnostics. That includes, you know, any other services other than a mammogram.
Michael? Thank you, Mayor. I just want to announce that over the last couple meetings, there's been some ordinances and resolutions passed authorizing the refunding of some of our outstanding debt. We were anticipating a savings of approximately $400,000 over 15 years. We blew through that. The savings is approximately $490,000 over those 15 years, with a $45,000 reduction in our debt service for next year. So we're actively, you know, monitoring the fiscal markets to make sure that we can refinance as best as possible to continue to try to save as much money as possible. And I anticipate another announcement in the next 3 to 6 months with one of our larger debts with NJEIT. So far we're doing very well on the debt service. Thank you.
Thank you.
Matters from this. Moving on to the public portion, may I have a motion to open the public comment portion of the meeting with a three-minute time limit for each speaker?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order and, after appropriate warning, may terminate any further comments from that speaker. Any comments?
Nobody wants to speak?
We're going to close the public.
Okay.
Is this on? I'm Bill Stuckey, and I work for Pat Fasano, Fasano Properties, and I wanted to talk about a couple of things, the pace of development in the WRA and the properties that are in the WRA, which can't be developed, that are in sort of limbo right now. And I wanted to talk about how the pace of development and the value of those units affects the tax receipts by the city. Things progress slowly. A little bit of the history that I researched. Things progressed slowly from 2002 to 2010. There were approximately 250 units built at North Beach and Wesley Grove, for an average of about 40 a year. Since iStar took over in 2010, there have been 90 units built, 28 at the Vibe, the South Grand has 28, and the Monroe has 34. And that pace of development is about an average of 15 units per year. And the WRA calls for somewhere around 3,000 units to be built. And obviously, at this pace, it could be another two decades before significant units are built down there and generating significant tax revenue for the city. If you look at what iStar has planned, they're finishing up the Monroe and it's pretty much sold out, and they're going to move to 1101 Ocean, the Esperanza, which has, just so the people here, if they haven't read about it on their website, it has some retail, about 55 hotel rooms and 128 condominiums they're going to sell. And we're developers and we are working on some projects on Main Street Memorial. But we know that, oh, I only have 53 seconds. I just saw that. I wanted to talk about two other things in my 45 seconds. In New Brunswick, they have built 1,704 housing units in 2014 and 15 with a retail value of about $320 million, generating $8 million a year in tax receipts for the city. And iStar, at their current pace, as I mentioned, it would take another 15 or 20 years to build out the waterfront redevelopment area. If they built 1,500 units there, over the next 5 years, and there's, as you all know, significant demand for housing in Asbury Park, there is no supply, that would generate $28 million a year in tax revenue, $280 million over 10 years, and over $500 million over 20 years. And I know you could do great things with that if you had those tax receipts. Sorry I went over.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to continue on that theme because there's nothing to get a developer moving like competition. When you have no competition at all, I mean, you can move at a snail's pace. I mean, certainly those numbers are embarrassing, to say the least, to produce those types of numbers in that many years. You know, we took people's property in 1986 here. It's been 30 years. I'm chomping at the bit to get to the planning board to build, and I can't build on my lots. So I have 15 properties in WRA, three of them have buildings that are producing income, and the other 12 are vacant lots. Those 12 vacant lots cost me $80,000 a year. I was promised by the city in 2012 that an ordinance would be passed to remove those properties from the redevelopment zone, and I'd be able to develop those properties. You know, on my lots alone, I could build 200 units for the city of Asbury Park. I am ready and willing and able to start building, and I need the city council to support me, really spend some time with me, and understand how we can move this forward. It says very clearly in the Politan decision that a decision should be made by the master developer as to whether or not these properties are going to be acquired. If not, they can be excluded from the redevelopment zone. That's unilaterally, you can do it. Without asking Brian, you can remove those 43 properties right now. I had a meeting with the mayor and Eileen and Michael a month ago. You were going to call your attorney and get back to me in a week. It's been a month, I haven't heard anything, okay? So in the meantime, we went to see Paul Fernicola, and Paul agrees with us that 100% the city council can unilaterally remove those 43 properties from the redevelopment zone. Now think about it, the Berkeley Carteret, that's not in the redevelopment zone. The Miramar wasn't in the redevelopment zone, I developed it. Kingsley Arms was not in the redevelopment zone, that was excluded. The hotel, the brand new hotel, Billy Resnick's house and the house next door, Hatchick's house, were excluded from the redevelopment zone, and they were all developed as single lot development. You can get around this thing. If you can't make a deal with Brian on single lot development exclusively, just remove those 43 properties now by ordinance from the redevelopment zone, and then just like Hatchick and just like the hotel, which were not full lot developments, I can move forward tomorrow. I have plans drawn for a seven-lot assemblage that I have in the waterfront for 134 units. I have plans drawn that I would share with you. I have plans drawn for a 29-unit building. I have plans drawn for a 15-unit building. I know Trip Brooks, because I was in his office, has plans for a 20-unit building on First. Okay? We're going to meet with Brian tomorrow. I'm here today, and I'm putting Brian on notice. I can't do it anymore, okay? I'm going to be 61 years old. I mean, it's going to take me 10 years to finish what I want. I can't be doing this when I'm 80 years old. I want to be done. Let me build on my lots. You'll get the revenue, okay? You need the revenue.
Roy Helfrick, 4th Avenue. And on a different note, I also, I want to mention that in addition to the planting that's going on this Saturday, the following Sunday on September 25th, the Environmental Commission is sponsoring a garden tour of the areas that we take care of in the city. There's actually six plots or six gardens on the tour. It's free, it doesn't cost anything. And we're gonna have volunteers from the commission at each of the places talking about the plants that are there, what was there before, how we developed those areas. I think the most noticeable one is Merchants Park, right across the street by Brando's there. That was done in about a year, which was amazing. And I also want to thank very much the council and the administration that's currently here, because with their help, we've been able to get so much more done in in this past year than we have probably in prior years. Because the DPW has been very much engaged, the city planner, Michael, everybody, along with the council. So it just makes Asbury Park a much better place to live in. Thank you.
Thank you, Roy.
Good evening. Dolly Stornesky, Sunset Lane, Asbury Park. I am here to urge everyone to update our stop signs, our traffic lights. We're welcoming thousands of people into our city, and they're using it as a playground, and they have no respect for our traffic. There are a number and increasing traffic accidents weekly. I was in a very serious one August 15th, Kingsley and 3rd Ave. We were coming north on Kingsley. The stop sign on 3rd Ave happened to be down. The gal admitted she did not stop, kept going. We only saw her in our windshield, and there was a terrible collision. The airbags went off, our car was demolished. It was awful, and I'm still a nervous wreck when I drive. Since then, there have been many accidents, particularly in that area, and on Grand Avenue. For some reason, that used to be my favorite because I avoided the lights on Main, and I've heard a number of accidents of people coming through, not stopping once again, especially on Grand and Sunset Ave. So we need to update stop signs and we need more lights in the city. We are a big city now. We have people coming from all over and we're suffering on the downside of that if we don't have proper traffic. Thank you.
Thank you.
JCP&L and DPW have been working over the last couple weeks to fix this issue. Actually, it goes back a little bit further, a couple months with it. It's been determined as of yesterday that there's an issue with the box where we have to run about a 10-foot line to be able to hook up the electric for the light to JCP&L's box to be able to turn it on. Once we can possibly turn it on, JCP&L is going to have to do some possible repairs to their box. So we have a solution. It's going to take some time to get everyone up and running, but we have a solution for it. We're going to install a more permanent stop sign also there, but we're working on fixing the light issue, which is taking a little bit while to pinpoint where it went wrong.
How many lights can we expect? Are they all coming? Just that one on Kingsley?
Correct.
Yes. Yeah.
Just one light. And I think the whole situation with the stop signs needs to be reviewed. We only have the one on stanchions, and to be perfectly fair, the gal who hit me, even if the stop sign was up, you can't visually see it coming down the street. We need proper stop signs on every block coming into the intersection.
As I said, we're upgrading the sign. We're going to put the largest sign that's allowable by law there. But
it can be allowable by law, but people are going to be hurt. We're lucky we were in the Jeep. We have a big red Jeep. If I was in my little bug, I wouldn't be here today. I'm thinking of everybody else, but and people are causing more accidents. We need more than one light. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is very spontaneous. That was Dolly, and I'm Polly Shulga on Fifth Avenue. This is a great segue into our complete streets policy, which I just happened to post on Nextdoor today. Some of you may have seen it. We had a little back and forth with a couple of citizens of the city talking about safe streets in general. And if any of you are interested, I really don't have a whole lot to say. I just want to introduce, I happen to have made a couple of copies, but I ran out of paper tonight. If any of you want to take a look at the complete streets policy that the city adopted last year, it's on that Nextdoor thread, and I'm pretty sure it's on the city website. Yes. So the Complete Streets policy adopted last year covers all of this, covers stop signs, covers crosswalks, covers bike paths, bike lanes, and a complete infrastructure for everybody to be able to use the streets safely. And it is a life and death situation, regardless of what the Tri-City News editor said last week. It's not like we want something and we're wild-eyed fanatics. This is an important issue for everybody who uses the streets in the city, not just visitors, not just tourists, which we're very grateful for, the revenue, but the people who live here who use bikes and walk because they don't have cars. It's super important that we have safe streets for everybody. Car-to-car, car-to-pedestrian, bicycle-to-pedestrian, everybody uses the streets one way or another. That's it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Good evening, Dan Harris, 17 Ridge Avenue. Let Pat build on his lots. He's been waiting a long time. And by doing that, I remember talking to him one day, and he was talking about how many citizens of Asbury Park would be employed. And the more you build, the more you have, the more people work, the less crime you have. One hand goes with the other, and it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. But my biggest concern is something that I've been talking about for over a year and a half, and that is the enclosure of garbage in Asbury Park. In all other cities that I go around where you have dumpsters, they are totally enclosed. For some particular reason in Asbury Park, they're only enclosed on three sides. Garbage flows all over the place. People dump outside the dumpsters. Those who miss the dumpsters, they look horrible. And it's a quality of living thing that I'm talking about. I have taken pictures. I have come down and talked to code enforcement people. I have come down and talked to Mr. McCune. Talked to him on the telephone about it, and nothing gets done. I don't know how hard it is for the city to say, look, it's an ordinance. You're supposed to enclose your garbage, and it doesn't get done. Okay, and I'm not saying this is an East Side, West Side issue. This is a quality of life issue. This is a cleanliness issue. People put beds out there with bed bugs in it. You got mice crawling in there. You got rats crawling in there. And it just seems like no matter how much I cry in the last year and a half, nobody seems to care because nothing gets done about it. I'm not asking for an answer tonight because I don't want an answer. I want to see some action on it. And if you really care about people in the city and the quality of life, at least close in their garbage. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, Rita Moreno, 8th Avenue. I didn't see the beach report, but I know we made more money than we did last year. My children really enjoyed the beach this summer, but the one thing they noticed, and I hope it's going to be corrected, is that they need new showers at the beach. They were saying that you should go look at the ones in Matasquan, and being we made all this money and we can't spend it any other place than the beach, I think you should look at that and get all new shower heads down there. They're the same ones. My kids are full grown and almost senior citizens, and they've still got the same shower head and the wood. So that's the one complaint. Number two is I'd like to know who sent out the letter for the $50 tax bill. I was just wondering who sent that letter out and why it was sent out. I know why, but I don't know why it was sent to people that own one-family houses, and then you got razzle-dazzle, and we're all paying the same price, $50. I thought that was very unfair that that letter went out the way it did. There was no thought put into it, and the other thing is, whoever wrote it doesn't know this city. We have a huge laundry on Memorial Drive that services the whole country, and they're going to pay $50 too? I mean, like, there's something wrong with that whole letter and what it was about. I know you stopped it now, but it's not, I mean, there's no, I mean, you mailed it out to 4,500 taxpayers. I mean, it's such a waste what goes on in this city. Just a small item like that, that there was no thought put behind it. Oh, $50 to each person. Person like me that lives in a one-family house, $50. It's not the $50. It's the manner in which it was done. And it should be looked at. It's an insult to the taxpayers of this city to get a letter like that. Why don't you go after the commercial properties that are using all the water, for one thing? And you would have probably got most of it. And then the remainder, you could do something with that, with a homeowner that has a one-family house. I mean, I know what mine was for that month, but I don't know if everybody, I know a lot of people paid it, so what's going to happen to that? And the last thing I wanted to talk about is parking. I couldn't park in front of my house if I tried for 10 weeks. You have people on the street that are there for days at a time. We used to have an ordinance in this town. If you were parked 3 days, you could call up the police department. And a patrol officer named Cook used to come down and either tow it or put a ticket on it. I mean, like, you can't have people parking in front of your house for a week, and they have the huge vans, and they don't have commercial license plates. I know you can't do anything about that. But, I mean, something has to be done about these people that live, like, in Deal Towers. One guy has three vans.
Okay, Rita, wrap it up.
Okay.
No, I mean,
I want to know who sent the letter.
What?
I want to know who sent that letter.
It's winding down again.
Who? You?
No. We haven't answered yet. We're trying to fix the clock.
Yeah. What?
We're fixing the clock.
It's not moving.
We haven't answered yet. Hold up.
Concerning the parking, if you see the car there that long, call, because just this week we had two complaints. They came into me. I told Salerno the cars were towed. So if you see the extended parking, just call us. The cars were towed. Concerning the $50 tax bill, that was me. And I'll tell you how the thought process was with it. We have approximately 4,000 sewer paying properties. And we had a deficit of $200,000 in the sewer utility. That deficit was because the previous tax collector didn't upload a month correctly into our software, which is called Edmunds. So that 1 month wasn't billed. So we had to get our money back somehow because, one, we have a deficit and we're owed $200,000. So we didn't have, one, a good data set to work off of to sit there and try to figure out who owes what, whether yours is a single family home or the laundromat. So the simple math was simple. We're owed $200,000, there's 4,000 properties, $50 a pop. And we set it up as a fee. Now that's a big thing. We heard a ton of complaints, so we stopped it. So the people who have paid are gonna be credited in the future. So they're not losing anything. Right now we're waiting for two proposals from outside firms to do the billing and to calculate as it is per usage. The difference between that is big, because as a fee, it's one thing. If we're sending it as a bill and you don't pay within a certain time frame, it's going to go to accelerated tax sale. So doing it as a fee, and this is the thought process that you said didn't take place, we would have more time to recoup it and more time for people to pay. But since now we're going to do it, we're going to spend money to have an outside firm do this work, because we can't do it internally. We can't go back into our software. It's gonna come now as a bill, which means it's gonna have to be paid, and if it's not paid, it goes to an accelerated tax sale. So we were trying to avoid those things in my thought process. The reason why we can't do it internally and upload it into the software is this is a 15 bill. And once the fiscal year ends on 12/31 and we roll over our financial software to 2016, that 15 year is shut off and considered quote unquote archived. So we can't go back and manipulate the data. So now we have this huge Excel sheet that has a bunch of information on it. The problem that we would have is, and this is just a small example, is if someone stopped service mid-month, how do we do that? How would we be able to do it? And that's what our consultants that we're trying to get these prices from are struggling with too, is how do we get this to be fair, especially for people that moved out during this month? How do we recoup that money? So it was a very long and arduous thought process between myself, the tax collector, the CFO. I was the one who authorized it. I'll take full responsibility for that. It came down to simple math and not trying to hurt residents later on with the accelerated tax sale and requiring the payments of us trying to work with people. The whole situation is bad because the previous collector didn't bill it. So at the end of the day, we have a sewer utility that's used to pay sewer that we can't operate the right way because we collected less money. And there's a technical side of this. If you have a deficit in a utility, whether it's a parking utility, a beach utility, a sewer utility, any utility under the law, you're actually supposed to raise taxes the next year to recoup that. So not only would you have been hit with a deficit in the sewer utility, but your taxes would have went up $200,000 to recoup this. So doing it this way, we stopped a larger tax increase and did it as a one-time bill and revenue, instead of hitting everyone with an even larger tax increase that we would have to because of the MUA to get the transitional aid. So it wasn't just, you know, a willy-nilly decision. We looked at what this would do on the tax rate, because we couldn't do it, what it would do on an accelerated tax sale. It was simple math. I take full responsibility. We're looking to do it per service, which is a fair way. But we're correcting it. And I've always said, you know, if we screw up, we're going to screw it up. It got screwed up. The audit found it. The system was in place. The final result is still horrible that it wasn't billed and people owe us money. And, you know, the only thing we can say is we're sorry that this happened. We're glad the audit caught it. We're glad that we saw that there was a deficit. Internally, you know, we have the full-time CFO now who looks at the revenue. On tonight's agenda is a resolution to do a performance metric software where we're going to be able to forward face these things so that everyone can see it. So we're taking steps to fix it. At the end of the day, there was an error. The audit caught it. We need to make ourselves whole. Any way you look at it, it's just horrible because we're asking people for money for something that we screwed up last year in last June. So, you know, from the city side, and I wasn't even here at this point in time, the tax collector wasn't here, and neither was the CFO. You know, we're sorry it has to happen, but we have to fix these errors in the past. And it, quite honestly, it just sucks. It just sucks having to go back and saying, look, this was screwed up. We have to ask for more money. We're sorry for it, but at the end of the day, you know, we need to be made whole because we need to operate.
Didn't the auditor say it was $400,000?
No, it's $200,000. He said it when he was here during his
Yeah, I remember.
It was $200,000.
Okay. Well, thank you for the explanation.
Thank you,
Rita. I'm glad I get to be Jerry Scarano's opening act and not his closer. I'm Doug McQueen for Wesley Court. And I'm here on behalf of the Complete Streets Coalition. I just wanted to reiterate some of the things that Polly said and make a couple points that back up Dolly Sterneski's concerns. You know, a lot of people think that the Asbury Park Complete Streets Coalition has been solely focused on improving Main Street. And while that is mostly true, it's not the whole picture. And a lot of you on the council know that. We have a handful of experts that volunteer their time to look at best practices for street design to make Asbury Park's streets, sidewalks, and other thoroughfares safer for everyone, bikes, pedestrians, and drivers. And some of the things that Dolly pointed out, we are more than capable of helping the city by making suggestions about some of the best practices that can be followed. And we've asked if we could participate in that way over and over in the last year, and we haven't actually received a meaningful response. So I'm here at the microphone again tonight to ask yet again if you would include us as a community group, as an organization that can give you answers on how to solve some of these problems, to calm traffic, to make streets more accessible and make them safer. And all we 3 minutes at a microphone isn't enough when you talk about some of these issues. And we have urban planners that work with us. We have at least 3 urban planners that work with us. We have libraries of information. And this stuff is important to us. And I know sometimes the city, because of a lot of other issues on its plate, has to manage by triage, and that's fine. But we can help calm that triage if you will just accept our offers of help. We really, really want to help get things implemented, and over, there have been too many times where we've missed opportunities to make the streets safer. So I'm here at the microphone tonight just to ask again if we can participate to help the city calm traffic, make traffic flow better, and make the streets safer. That's all we can do is ask. Thank you.
Hello, Mayor and Council, Jerry Scarano, Long Branch. So what I want to say is I believe we had a great summer in Asbury Park, the beachfront, lots of tourists. I'd like to ask, now that we have beach revenue that we never had before, maybe you may want to do an ad on the subways in New York, because we're closer to New York City than Fire Island and the Hamptons, and the train ride's probably cheaper to come down here. So I'd like to recommend that you start looking now to see how much it would cost to put an ad on the subway cars and tell people that we're closer than the other beaches and our water's cleaner. The other thing is, I've been asking you guys, we need monthly reports. It builds on what Doug was talking about. The citizen can help you. You need a budget committee. I know you don't want to hear that, but that's thinking out of the box. Because if you would have had a budget committee, why some people were on vacation, they may have realized the sewer bill was short, and they would have said maybe there was a way to calibrate the usage so someone in a condo in the Esperon or a Rita wouldn't have to pay $50, but the guy that does the laundromat would pay his thousands of dollars. You know, I told you this before, if people need a vacation between Memorial Day and Labor Day, maybe they don't need to work for you guys. You really got to think about that. The other thing is, I told you before, after Pat Fasano and Bill were talking, the developers are friendly people. When they go up and chat with you at the Diaz, when they hang out with you on Cookman Avenue, they're befriending you. They're not our friend. They're cutting deals for themselves. You got to realize that the developers are not your friends. The other thing is, you got to think out of the box if you want change. Then I didn't know about other New Brunswick with their development, but Warner used to talk about they built the Empire State Building in 1 year. iStar, it's there to make money for themselves. They're not worried about our tax revenue. And since I came to town, we had empty lots down there that are still not built. They knocked down perfectly good buildings ahead of time, not iStar, but the developers took the ratables off the tax map. You guys got to do something to hold people accountable. And first, you got to have goals for the city manager. I've been asking for the last four city managers, we need a timetable for the beachfront so people can see what's going on, to see how bad iStar is and Madison Marquette are. The pavilions should be built all running. We have 60 or 100,000 people come here in a week's time or whatever the numbers are. You got to hold people accountable. And it starts with the top, not the bottom. So can you guys give me any answers about the subway idea?
We'll look into it. We're having a meeting tomorrow with the beach supervisors, DPW, to go over the summer, to talk about what went well, what didn't go well, and to start planning for next year. So yeah, we'll talk about it tomorrow.
Okay, thanks a lot for listening to me.
No, thank you, Jerry.
Hi, good evening. I'm Patrick Ryan. My address is 503 6th Avenue in Asbury. A couple issues. One couple that actually popped up tonight. One, I was reminded, I almost got hit this summer on Kingsley trying to cross the street to go to the beach and had about a five-minute argument with various abusive obscenities thrown at me by the guy in the car. Because he didn't want to stop for me in the crosswalk and didn't feel like he should have to. I think one thing that you definitely need to do some more of is those little stanchions with the sign that says, reminding people that they are to stop if somebody's in the crosswalk, at least on the busy streets like Kingsley and Grand and wherever, because people don't. And they play chicken with you and it's really dangerous. The other issue was one I thought of because I live right by the corner of 6th and Grand, and I've observed about six accidents on that intersection just in the time I've been in my house, and until January I was only there weekends. I would think it might be prudent for each one of the intersections on Grand to have at least a blinking light, because the stop sign doesn't work. People don't either see it or don't pay attention to it, and they cruise right on through. And I've seen too many accidents. I can't imagine it's that much cost to get those lights, and at least there'll be more of a visual. The other, I understand that there was a quality of life meeting with folks in town last week, which unfortunately coincided with a night that I was involved with the Commission for Sunset Lake, so I could not be there. And previously I was up here mentioning that I thought you ought to consider some non-smoking beaches. And I again urge you to consider that. It is the 21st century. There is proven fact that secondhand smoke is dangerous. It is certainly unpleasant. And I can't tell you how many times this summer I have ended up upwind from cigars and cigarettes, and it is exceedingly unpleasant. It's a really easy prospect for you to make every other beach a smoking beach, and the ones in between a non-smoking beach. It doesn't take a lot. A couple signs, somebody to enforce it when people are going on and off the beach, and you've got non-smoking beaches, you've got smoking beaches, everybody ought to be happy. Not hard to do. I really would urge you to consider doing it. Thank you.
Those two topics, the smoking beaches and as far as the signs, and you're right, there's less signs this year than in past years. They're on tomorrow's agenda to be talked about. So both of those were listed to be on the agenda, but thank you for bringing them up. Thank you.
And that would require an ordinance, right, Michael, for smoking or not smoking?
Yes.
Tarita Jones, Neptune, former business owner in Asbury Park. Just a point of history. Stop lights, red lights, stop signs have been on Kingsley and Grand. There was no post-Sandy damage. Those lights were taken down with the construction that started on Kingsley. And it's only been the recent past couple of years. It's a hot mess going down those streets now. So whoever took them down, they can't put it on Sandy. They need to hurry up and get that in there. It's real critical. Second point, I'm a frequent complainer to the parking authority that's a nebulous cloud somewhere because these meters and little pay kiosks never work. I'm over at the dance school, Madison Avenue, notoriously. No tickets, no printouts, not working, won't take change. Cards may not get read. There has to be something done because this is a regular issue. I'm sick of harassing the shift commander. And I know if I'm having an issue, there are other people that are having the same problem. There has to be an answer because we're in 2016. Any comments, feedback, any updates?
Do you have more? Because I don't want to interrupt into your time.
Okay. That's enough right there.
The meters are horrible. They break all the time. It's been a topic of discussion here for the 10 months that I've been here. Twice this year, we've put out an RFP for a parking consultant. One of the roles of the parking consultant would be to research new meters that wouldn't cause a problem. The meter company that we get the parts from keeps all the stock in Canada. So it's not something that we can just go get off the shelf. It is a horrible, horrible problem. I was just looking yesterday and saw what meters were out. It's a problem. So we put out the RFP twice, both times. It wasn't what we were looking for, whether it was too expensive, whether they didn't meet the needs of what we were looking for, but we know we need someone to manage the parking better. So currently, due next Monday, is a position of transportation planner who would handle and coordinate to start off their career here, just that, of managing this parking mess, especially with the meters. There's two types of meters that are here. They are not friendly for this environment. I've actually received calls from other municipalities on the beach saying, would you recommend these meters? And the answer is no. Until we can get someone here who can spend the time to fix and work with the vendor, right now we're on time and materials. We know we need to replace all of them. We know that it is just a mess. It is frustrating. It's a horrible user experience. But right now we don't have, the ability to get out there and do it. We see it's broken, we call it in. It's not only people like yourself who call it into the police department, but we can actually monitor it online. So the parking staff does that and we can see when things go down. One of the more frustrating things, and I told this story a couple months ago, was when I talked to the company, they told us that they want us to tell us what's wrong with the meter. And my response was, but you can also see what's wrong because it's online. Why wouldn't you come out with the parts? Why are we telling you what's wrong when we have a contract with you? it's just a poor vendor, it's a poor contract, it needs to be fixed. We're getting there. It's frustrating. It's just a mess. But until we can get the meters fixed, it's just going to be frustrating.
As a grant evaluation research type person, scrap the company in Canada. Bring somebody IT, somebody that has background in doing evaluation, program of planning, because if you can do all of that, this shouldn't be a problem. Hire somebody internally for what it costs you to have that.
And that's part of the process is right now we do the maintenance on them. We do the maintenance on the equipment. We're not contracting with the company to do it. We're doing it ourselves.
That's what I'm saying.
But
you're already doing it.
It's not that. It's that the parts then break. And we have to go through the company to get the parts. And that's where they're based out of, I think it's New Brunswick. They have to order it. And they come from Canada.
In 2016, I'm a mechanical girl. You can go down the road and get your parts and come up with something else. There has to be a better way.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Sirois. I'm an Ocean Grove resident and a tenant at 603 Madison Avenue. Two questions / suggestions for your 200K sewer deficit. Question one, if you can please answer it. Why won't you or can't you move money from your beach and parking revenue to fill that deficit? Do you know the answer? Another suggestion / question is, did you file any kind of civil suit against whomever is the person who is liable for non-collection of revenue to your sewer authority? Third, as a suggestion, to reiterate what Tarifa is saying, I suggest that when you enter into contracts with companies that are not best suited to your needs, conduct a thorough due diligence. I say that from my background as a private detective. Doing due diligence on people and companies is what I do. I am not trying to promote myself. What I'm trying to explain to you is 9 times out of 10, when you do a thorough due diligence, you avoid these kinds of problems that you're having with your current contractor. And if you ever want to hear what that means thoroughly, I'll be happy to just sit down over a cup of coffee and explain to you how I do that process, or anybody with my background could do that for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Wait a second. We're going to answer your first two questions.
It's a utility, basically.
Well, there's I can answer all three. Concerning due diligence, there's actually a bill before the Senate and Assembly that is huge for municipalities. If someone does something bad in New Brunswick, a bad vendor, and New Brunswick marks them that they can't do work in New Brunswick ever again, it means absolutely nothing to us. Under New Jersey state law, the public contracts law right now, if someone is bad, it's only bad in one place and not bad statewide. It's a horrible standard. There's actually a bill being posted that says the state needs to create a database of the bad vendors. That will be huge because we can do due diligence and call, but if they're the lowest responsible and responsive bidder, by law we have to take them. And this contract was 6 or 7 years ago where those standards weren't in there. I agree with you 100%.
I hear you, and I know more about that topic as well. We won't take time, but the due diligence I'm referring to is so much deeper and broader than what you're referring to. So maybe we should have a conversation. But go ahead with your next thought.
Considering civil suits, we don't do that in municipalities. What it is, it would go after the bond. So we'd actually be paying ourselves to pay the self that was missed. This wouldn't rise to that because it would be malfeasance. I think this, quite honestly, was just an incompetent screw-up. So to get the money back from them, the bond is held by us, we'd be paying ourselves. And the sewer deficit, you can't transfer from utility to utility. You can transfer from utility to general operating, the current fund, but we can't say, oh, there's a deficit in sewer, let's use transportation money or beach money. It doesn't work that way under the fiscal affairs law.
Okay, thank
but thank you.
Motion to close.
All in favor? on to item J, minutes. I have the August 8th workshop meeting minutes, August 10th executive session minutes, August 10th regular meeting. Motion?
Move it.
Hey, Pat, can you give me the Politan decision? I didn't know you were leaving. Can you give me the decision that you're saying says that? Okay, or just email it to me? Because I read it differently.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Fleet?
Okay. What's going on?
Sorry, that was me. I apologize.
Roll call. Go ahead. You got the motion in a second.
You just did.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
If you're going to have conversations, I appreciate you taking them outside. Thank you.
We're on to item K, adoption of the 2016 municipal budget. We have resolution 2016-355, resolution to amend the 2016 calendar year budget. Do I have a motion?
Second.
Question. Michael, please explain this. This is because we finally got our transitional aid number. We applied for $1.2 million, and we plugged the $1.2 million into the budget that we introduced many months ago. And we got a letter last week saying the 1.2 was cut down to $1 million. So we had to fund that $200,000. So the budget stayed the same, and there was not a larger tax increase. So just fill in the blanks.
There are no blanks other than it was 275. We asked for 1.275, we got one. There's no tax increase. What we're using is transportation utility fund balance. What that means for fund balances, it's money from 14. In 2014, whatever money was left gets moved into 15, which is called the reserve. The reserve then lapses to what's called fund balance or surplus, as is commonly referred to, but the correct term is fund balance. In 16, we're using the $275,000 that was in the parking utility fund balance to make up the difference. The state signed off on it at about 1 o'clock this afternoon. We're now able to adopt the budget, which we're recommending. There's no tax increase. There's no change in any line items. It's just straight math.
There's no increased tax increase. There is a tax increase from as per the original budget. Roll call.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to 2016-356, the adoption of the 2016 municipal budget. Do I have a motion?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to consent agenda resolutions. All matters listed on the consent agenda are presented collectively to the City Council and will be considered for approval with one vote. These matters are to be considered routine in nature, and there will be no individual discussion of these items. If discussion is desired by one or more council members as to any particular item, then said item shall be removed from the consent agenda and considered separately. We have 2016-357. Approving special events wedding applications as presented on September 12, 2016.
Melody, can you pull that? The 357,
sure.
We're going to add conditions to one of the special events.
Okay. We have 2016-358, a resolution authorizing the payment of payroll in the amount of $2,095,491.67.
Mayor, before you guys vote on that, for 2016-357, do you want to pull one application and approve the other two?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's fine.
Yeah. Okay. So they need to.
Okay. Okay. So 2015-357, we are removing the zombie walk from the consent.
Correct.
Okay, we're on to 2016-359. Resolution canceling balances of reserve for unappropriate grants. 2016-360, a resolution authorizing the acceptance of COPS in SHOP Summer Short Initiative 2016. 2016-361, a resolution authorizing the acceptance of drunk driving enforcement grant. 2016-362, a resolution authorizing the acceptance of the Bulletproof Vest Partnership. 2016-363, a resolution requesting permission for dedication by rider for revenues derived from donations required by NJSA 48:5-29 Senior Center. 2016-364, a resolution requesting permission for the dedication by rider for revenues derived from donations required by NJSA 48:5-29 National Night Out. 2016-365, a resolution requesting permission for the dedication by rider for the revenues derived from donations required by NJSA 48:5-29 Police Community Relations. 2016-366, authorizing compensation plan to Brian Migliorasi upon his separation of employment. 2016-367, resolution to credit sewer account 1011 Monroe Avenue, Block 505, Lot 20. 2016-368, resolution to terminate sewer account billing, 408 3rd Avenue, Block 3405, Lot 3. 2016-369, resolution to terminate sewer account billing, 412 5th Avenue, Block 3504, Lot 2. 2016-370, award of contract for regional contribution agreement project 705 Sunset Avenue. 2016-371, a resolution authorizing the refund of a security deposit paid by Ted Johnson for a lease at the Transit Center. 2016-372, a resolution authorizing the refund of a security deposit paid by Topps Taxi, Inc. for a lease at the Transit Center. Do I have a motion?
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Now, do we want to add, go to the zombie?
So I think for the zombie walk, we wanted to just change the closing of Cookman Avenue from 12 to 4 to Rolling Street closures. Is that correct?
But not before 4 on Cookman.
Yes.
All right.
Right?
Yes. Correct.
And then we also wanted to add signs up 48 hours in advance saying, please move your car by 4 o'clock on October 2nd. That's the date of the zombie walk. And then we also wanted to ensure, and I'm not sure you need to put this in it, and Leisha knows, Leisha I think has talked to all of us in one way, shape, or form about this. We're gonna make sure police know no barricades up until 4, okay.
And Michael and Leisha look at the signs the police are gonna put up before they go up to make sure we're all on the same page. Again, this was brought up Monday night. There was problems last year, so we're correcting it, and so everything should work out well.
And with the possibility to Yvonne's idea of moving it to possibly Madison next year.
After the zombie walk sometime in October, there's gonna be, like we're doing tomorrow with the beach, there's gonna be a meeting with everybody with the zombie walk to figure out what's going right, what went wrong, and what are we doing next year.
Okay, do I have a motion specifically for the zombie walk?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to M, individual resolutions. We have 2016-373, a resolution authorizing the payment of bills in the amount of $3,953,775.69. We are removing a T&M bill. It is purchase order 16020758 in the amount of $1,009.24.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman? Just from the ones that you would?
Yes.
Okay. Councilmember Chapman is abstaining from bills that she has indicated to me she's abstaining from. Okay. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to 2016-374, authorizing an application for non-federal cost share program. Do I have a motion?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-375, authorizing a one-year extension for private collection of municipal court day. Is there a motion?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-376, a resolution to join New Jersey Sustainable Energy Joint Meeting. Questions, comments?
Move it.
Motion.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-377, authorizing the acquisition, support, and maintenance of software.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-378, authorizing change order number 3 for Springwood Avenue Park.
Move it. Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to 2016-379, a resolution of the City of Asbury Park authorizing the execution of and a modification to the cooperation agreement by and between the City of Asbury Park and the Housing Authority of the City of Asbury Park and affirming the properties and projects of the Housing Authority of the City of Asbury Park remain governed by the cooperation agreement. Motion?
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-380, a resolution ratifying the fire chief's acceptance on behalf of the Asbury Park Department, a staffing for adequate fire and emergency response, SAFER grant from the Department of Homeland Security Federal Emergency Management Agency. Motion?
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yep.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
On to 2016-381, appointing members to the Zoning Board of Adjustment, Giuseppe Grello.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-382, a resolution authorizing in rem foreclosure proceedings related to certain real properties located within the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey.
Move it.
Second. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
2016-383, resolution authorizing a lien on two properties. Motion.
Move it.
Second.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
No.
Okay. Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
The two properties that we have them listed, I didn't see it.
Yes.
Yes, they're Johnny Max and the Savoy. Because there's litigation going on and they've dragged us into it, so.
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
She's out of the room.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Shall we wait for Deputy Mayor?
Yes.
Move on.
Yes.
Okay. 2016-384, a rescinding resolution 2016-289 and adopting this resolution for an award of a generator for a municipal complex.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn? Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to item N, ordinances. Second reading, public hearing, we have 2016-35, a capital ordinance appropriating the sum of $87,000 for acquisition of various capital items and park improvements. A motion to open ordinance 2016-35 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn? Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Any comments from the public?
It's open to the public.
We did.
This is a capital surplus ordinance. Capital surplus is, as the example I gave on Monday, I know you weren't here, but that say the city puts a capital ordinance in place for $100,000. Under the law, you're supposed to use 5% down payment. So we would have to spend $5,000 in cash to borrow the $100,000. At some point in time, we decide not to do the project. That $5,000 just is still there, and it comes back and it's a little bit more technical, into what's called capital surplus. So say, for example, we do $100,000, $5,000, the project only costs us $50,000. We would get half of that money back, the $2,500. That comes then into capital surplus. So this was one of the things in the audits, like we talked about a couple months ago, about the trust accounts. We started going back through all our old ordinances to cancel that sort of cash. That sort of cash equaled $87,000. We found one, the new CFO found one going, an ordinance going back to 1994. So these things were on the books. There was cash charged to the ordinance. It just was sitting there doing nothing. So you cancel the ordinance, you cancel the cash, it comes into what's capital surplus. Capital surplus, you can still do whatever you want with it. You just need to go through the proper management of doing an ordinance. So this is an ordinance to get us some wish list items. The treasurer doesn't sit at a desk, he sits at a table. We're buying some furniture. We're buying some new filing cabinets that have locks and are fire resistant because we don't have any for any of the personnel records. Right now, when we send out tax bills, the entire tax department, all five of them, sit there and do it by hand. So we're going to get a folding and stuffing machine, which is also going to help accounts payable be able to get his bills out, because he sits there twice a month for a day and a half just stuffing envelopes and folding. So we're using this to fill some gaps, to make ourselves more efficient, and it's money that was just sitting there doing nothing for many, many years that we canceled. Got it off the books.
Motion to close ordinance 2016-35 to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-35.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Clayton?
Councilmember Clayton.
I know. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to 2016-36, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 3. Police regulations by adding Section 3-4, urinating and defecating in public, of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Motion to open ordinance 2016-36 to public.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Any comments from the public?
I'd like to be heard. Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Motion
the
to
fact that we have to add that is.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-36.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Moore? Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
I'm done. We are on to 2016-37, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 7, Traffic, Subsection 7-41, Metered Parking, of the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. A motion to open ordinance 2016-37 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Any questions from the public?
Motion to close.
One comment on that ordinance, that the identified location be free and clear of obstruction. By
what number?
The
2016-38.
Not there yet. We're on 37. Oh, sorry about that.
Motion to close.
I thought you would pass and did the motion for that.
Motion to close 2016-37 to the public.
Move it.
Move it.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-37.
Move it.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to 2016-38, establishing a restricted parking space for use by handicapped persons at property located at 4 Deal Court in the City of Asbury Park, and amending and supplementing Section 7-36, entitled Handicapped Parking, of Chapter 7, Traffic, of the Revised General Ordinances of the City of Asbury Park. A motion to open ordinance 2016-38 to the public.
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Okay, as I was saying before, be sure that within that whereas, with the identified space location, that it's free and clear of obstruction from signage, trees, flower pots. Every handicapped space you have within the city on the east side is obstructed by something. And I brought that up before. Public Works really needs to evaluate that.
This was specifically
looked at by the police department, and they give us the how many feet from here and how many feet from there. So I'm sure we'll check, but I'm sure they
within
did.
Within that footage, it should not be obstructed because it defeats the purpose of a handicapped accessible space.
I agree with you, and I would think the police department would also. The ones you're talking about, the beachfront, the ones you're talking about, the beachfront, were not put in by the police department.
Motion to close ordinance 2016-38 to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-38. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Right, we are on to adjournment. Motion to adjourn?
Move it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Oh my God.